When the pulling hand overtakes the line of the forward knee, the rear angle of the paddle increases. Then the paddle should exit. The extraction of the paddle from the water is quick, clean, and doesn't cause the canoeist to lose his balance. The paddle comes out sideways, moving up and away from the canoe, thanks to the movement of the arms and the rising of the torso. The top arm moves away, and the pulling arm rises slightly. With the speed stroke, we must avoid a high exit, which would make the canoeist lose balance and time. The exit should be easy and quick, otherwise something is wrong. The canoe should not suffer from unnecessary movements. The air transfer links the exit with the entry. Paddle follows a straight path, ascending if the entry is high, and parallel to the water if the entry is lower. During this phase, the canoeist must adopt a position for a good entry. The legs advance, the torso bends and rotates, the hips maintain continuity between the torso and the pushing thigh. The top arm rises away, and the pulling arm moves in a straight line until it is horizontal with the water. The blade travels at an angle and turns at the last moment to adopt the correct position of entry. The most common errors in exit and air transfer are those which make the whole movement slow down or lose inertia, besides errors in the previous stages. Hips placed too far behind, balance problems, etc. An analysis can help us to understand what happens in each stage of a stroke, but we mustn't forget that each stage is part of a complete movement, and each stage will be influenced by the previous one, which will then influence the following one. The paddling technique represents a basic pattern which the coach will adapt and use to get the most out of each of his canoeists. This way, each of them will develop his own personal style. We think it is wrong to impose a rigid following of one particular style for everybody. Here we can see that among different canoeists of a similar level, there are appreciable differences in paddling style, dictated by their individual characteristics. Although the steering is part of the stroke, we think it deserves to be studied apart. Owing to the hydrodynamic characteristics of the canoe, its lack of a rudder and the asymmetrical paddling, the canoe tends to steer in different degrees towards the offside. A situation which can be made worse by winds, strong currents, or waves. But it is the lateral wind which most influences the direction of the canoe. Laterally, the canoe has a greater surface exposed to the wind at the rear. If the canoeist is the center of the canoe's turning point, the wind will push the rear of the canoe as there is a great area exposed, causing it to turn. When the canoe is in movement, this means it will turn towards the side of the wind. If the wind comes from the paddling side, the canoe will turn in that direction. The canoe will move in a straight line with a minimum of effort. The maneuvering technique is used by the canoeist in order to move in a certain direction or to correct his course. Offside steering is the most commonly used due to the canoe's characteristics. It is performed by the steering arm and helped by the pulling arm. When the blade is about to exit, the blade is turned up to 45 degrees. And on exit, it meets the resistance of the water, which produces an effect in the opposite direction, moving the bow of the canoe. In this way, the canoe moves in a straight line or towards the paddling side. To make the steering effective, it must fit into the stroke perfectly. And besides steering the canoe, it should pass unnoticed. It shouldn't slow down the stroke or cause loss of balance. It should be performed only by the necessary amount and at the right moment. Evidently, in a race, a lot of factors influence the strength of the wind, its direction, the speed of the canoe, buoys. Then we must know how much we should steer in each circumstance. The canoeist's sensitivity, which increases through training and experience, will tell him how much and when. In adverse conditions, when offside steering slows down the speed of the canoe, we can use onside steering. Onside steering is based on the same principle. On entering the water, the steering hand turns the handle slightly so that it enters the water moving towards the canoe 20 to 45 degrees and separated 15 to 20 centimeters from the side. In order to make this steering effective, we must use the weight of the body on entry. In this way, the inertia created by the falling of the torso produces the desired effect with little effort and hardly any loss in the effectiveness of the stroke.